Thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity to share some experience and some ideas on where we are going. And obviously, I've worked with biotechnology for more than 30 years, as you mentioned, starting as a scientist. And actually, I was part of the team who brought the first GMO lipase to the market back in 1988. That was before we had any kind of regulation. We cloned a natural lipase into a fungal host. There was no way, only one way, a place in the world we could produce it. That was Japan. In Japan, it was okay. So we produced the first batch in Japan. We had to fly it to Denmark to formulate it and fly it back to Japan to sell it. And we did that around the Christmas, 1987 to 1988. That led to that Denmark got the first gene technology law in the world. So we got a regulation under where you could produce GMO products under contained conditions. But that was the very early days, and where it actually was a nightmare to get approval for these, because nobody really knew how to get approvals. I'm not saying that it becomes simpler, because now all the lawyers have been trying to make rules for us for the last 30 years, and that have actually made it maybe even more complicated. But before we go into some of all the stories I can tell you, and I'll try to put you in a little bit of different perspective. Because if you look at the technology development we have gone through, then right now we have an explosion of new technological opportunities. And you all know this, that just within the time we have been here, the number of technological shifts we have seen have been incredible. And then I will say that what we are going to see the next 10 years will outpace what we have seen the last 30 by many, many folks. And so to predict where we are going is not going to be easy. Unfortunately, I'm getting older. I think it would be fantastic to be a young biotechnologist these days, because you have so many opportunities. Hopefully, I have 10 or 15 years where I can be part of this. But I'm sure that the next number of years is going to be incredibly exciting. If you look at what is happening globally, then we have what I would call an information overload. And I would also claim that we live under a cognitive deficit. Our brain is simply not able to handle the amount of information, the amount of data we are being loaded with. If you look at back in 2003, that was the first year we generated as much information as we have done in entire manhood history. So in 2003, we doubled the amount of information. In 2016, it took 3 hours to generate as much information as we did in 2003. And I think today, I don't have the number, but I guess we are maybe down to minutes where we double the amount of information. Just look at what happens in an internet minute. And of course, this is completely changing the way the world operates, the way companies work. Novozymes was for many, many years in a very, very good position. We had the largest R&D organization in the world. We knew more about microbes than anybody else. Nobody could compete with the 1,400 scientists we had. We had all the biodiversity, 10 times the biodiversity that anybody else had. That is not the case any longer. There are millions of scientists which can assess to this. And of course, that completely changed the dynamics. So you could say companies' impact to this is changing quite a bit right now. Then you all know the megatrends, global warming. We need to produce way more food. In certain areas, we have an aging population. Both in Europe, US and China, the population is aging very, very rapidly. Europe as such, population-wise, is becoming tiny, tiny, tiny. And all forecasts will tell you that it'll be less than 5% of this planet's population which lives in Europe. We like to live in megacities. At least this is a trend now that everybody are moving into the cities. I think, I don't even know the number of cities which have more than 15 million inhabitants now, and it's continued to explode. People don't want to live in the countryside, at least as it is right now. And then if you combine this with all what happens on the technology, not just biotechnology, but within robotization, automation, digitalization, that's really giving us a complete shift in technological opportunities. And then if we dive into what is happening when you look at gene technology and the impact of the cell factory. Then, as you heard, I've been part of a journey making cell factories for 30 years, and I'll still claim that there's nobody in the world who can produce protein cheaper than Novozymes.
But how long will that last? I don't know. Maybe not very long. There's absolutely no doubt that CRISPR-Cas9 is giving us a unique tool. I think, as you know, I was in charge of this large organization. I heard about this in May 2014. And I immediately went back to my scientists and said, this technology we need to master. And we need to be able to do it before I go on summer vacation. And we had all the tools in place. We had then an issue with a production train, a fungal production train. We used it for 50 years to produce proteins. It's, you can eat it. In Japan, they've been eating it for 2,000 years. But we unfortunately found out, because analytical technologies becomes better and better all the time, that unfortunately it had a small gene producing a little bit of antibiotics. And as this product was going into the food industry, we were not really pleased about sending a small, tiny, tiny, tiny amount of antibiotics into this food chain. And we tried to move that gene for more than 2 years with classic mutagenesis, and we could simply not get rid of the gene. And promise me, believe me, we had the best people for making classical mutagenesis, both in fungal and bacterial, and they couldn't crack the problem. 2 weeks with CRISPR-Cas9, we solved it. The gene was gone. And do you know the reason for we couldn't crack it with classical mutagenesis? We found out under this, the strain turned out to be diploid. So there was a backup gene. So each time we mutated on one gene, the other gene came in and repaired. And we had no clue of this. We worked with the strain for 50 years. We had no clue that it was diploid. So that's just to tell you that even though we think we know a lot, we don't know a lot. And of course, CRISPR-Cas9 is giving us a fantastic tool to really accelerate this. We talked a little bit about the time to make production strains. And there are many stories about this. CRISPR-Cas9 will help us big, big time making more efficient strains. At Novozymes, we, back in 2005, invested in a complete new technology which could, where you could cut and paste genes in and out. It took us 5 years to develop. It took our time to production strain down from 2 years to few weeks. So suddenly we could boost the number of new products we could make, because we could cut and paste the gene we wanted into a specific loci, and then we could produce big time. CRISPR-Cas9, of course, will make this something everybody can do, and they can do it whenever they want. And of course, you can do it so nobody can see if you use CRISPR-Cas9. You can also do it in a way where you tell it, or you could put in markers so you can detect it. But in reality, it will not be nobody will be able to control what the individual scientists have been doing with CRISPR-Cas9. So it's up to, you could say, the general society to set some ethical standards, in my mind. Then there's no doubt that the cost of gene sequencing, as you've seen, come down. Cost of artificial DNA, nobody bothers. You just order it on the internet. Next day, you have the probes you want. And of course, our knowledge on individual gene sequence and function in the cell have been increasing tremendously with all the information we can get from these new technologies. Then if we dive a little bit more into the production host as such, then at least the way we did it in Novozymes, we had a number of standard strains, and we made them better and better and better, and optimized them for very high carbon utilization and absolute high yields and short fermentation cycles, robust fermentation, so you don't get infections, easy recovery systems. And again, as I talk about, this cut and paste can give you almost ideal situation for optimizing the strain, because you can take out the unwanted genes, and the moment you find that this gene cluster is down-regulating your expression level, take it out, see what happens. On top of this, we will understand strain stability much better. There's been identified small sequences which we had not had a clue, which actually has huge influence on strain stability. And apparently these small segments, they travel around on the genome. And the more you have on this, then the more instability you have. The fewer you have of these, then you will see a slower integration. You could argue that this kind of the bacterial or fungal kind of immune system or resistance system, that if you get in an unwanted gene, you have these tiny, tiny fragments floating around, inserting in, putting in a stop codon in the unwanted gene. Something like that, I guess, is why nature put it in. of course, these smart production systems where you utilize all these and where you improve the strain stability will get better and better integrated. But it doesn't stop there. Computer system, synthetic pathways, we can design this way, way faster. And that's where artificial intelligence, and I'll come back to this a little later, really will pay a major difference. I have, and I've seen all of it now, that computer algorithms are way better at doing this than we as scientists are. So there's absolutely no doubt that the merge of artificial intelligence and gene editing will create a completely new world for all of us. So computer design pathways designed and tested in silico. You don't even need to put it into a strain. You use AI, it's already being used to make an optimal expression system to make out because you can screen way, way more pro sequences and kind of chaperones which stabilize the expression. All this can be done in the computer and will be done so. We'll also be able to make new recovery principles. We heard a little bit about protein A, which has been the big wonder for pharmaceutical product purification. Today you build in DNA tags, and you can build DNA tags with different affinities, so you can bind your protein or product to anything you like, to make both production efficient, to make purification efficient. So this will mean that we will be able to make easier and high yield recovery systems at much lower cost. It may also mean that we can make complete new ways of immobilizing proteins which we would like to stabilize or have in an immobilized form. So this opens a new set of opportunities as well. So a lot of new techniques which will completely change the way we work with biotech. And then what at least I call digital biotechnology. You heard from all the fantastic diversity we have in nature. But I need to take you then one step further up on the diversity tree. One enzyme, you could say, has 300 amino acids or maybe up to 600 amino acids. If you know that you have 20 possibilities of amino acids in each of these positions, then you have more combination opportunities in one enzyme than you have atoms in the universe. You can calculate after the mass we know of the universe, roughly how many atoms we have. And just in one enzyme, you have more combination opportunities than you have atoms in the universe. This means that we, in principle, can design whatever we like, because there's no limitations. At least that's what it tells me. But of course, you can have your view on this, and I'm sure we can have a discussion on this. Back in 2013, I bought a small, or Novozymes, but with me in charge, bought a small digital biotechnology company in San Francisco. They were able to make mega libraries. They could make, in one enzyme, 10 to 11 variants. So 100 billion variants in one pool, you could have a tiny, tiny test tube, and they could screen it. And that was the first time I saw a selection system, a non-living selection system which could make intelligent choices. Because the only way you can select 100 billion in one go is if your positive hits come out automatically. And they designed a system, really, really brilliant, where your positive hits come out automatically. And by that, we could completely change our, you could say, in silico development program. So we, in 14, we made the first 10 to the 11 libraries. And for the first time, we could change the catalytic turnover of an enzyme. It has always been a dream to module, can we? We could change the stability, we could change the heat profile, we could change the denaturation, we could change anything on an enzyme. We could never ever ask the enzyme to go faster. But digital biotechnology helped us increase the catalytic activity in first go factor of 6. So these laboratory evolution cycles for sure will give much more and much more diversity, much more precise selection. But it comes back to which selection criteria you give the system. And there, of course, you need to be smart, because you are completely dependent of how you put this together. You get what you ask for. And it's as simple as in nature. Nature is very, very good at making choices. It had done it for, should we say, 4 or 5 billion years on this planet. And it makes really, really wise choices. And when you make artificial evaluation system, it's the question you want to get answered, which get answered based on your screening tool. This, of course, leads to what do we do with all this data? If you make 100 billion enzymes in one go, how do you keep all your data points? How do you store this so it's meaningful information, so it's searchable, so you can compare? Because when you have run 1,000 or 10,000 runs of this, then you still need to be able to store this data, take it in a way so it's usable for the future. So maybe you can even apply digital systems to search in your database if you build it smart. And this is what's coming when you build algorithm and optimize protein molecule production, both from the cell, but also, of course, when you mutate individual proteins. And this is just around the corner. It's happening as we speak. So I would actually say a new data handling system, they are really, really needed. But I can tell you, Google, Verily, they're very, very far on this journey. You may not know it, but Google collects 6 terabytes per person, each person on this western part of the planet, every single day. And they're able to store it, they're able to track it, so they know way more about you than you think they do. And that's just because they are really, really good at putting these algorithms together. When we become as good in the biotechnology, we really have strong tools. So, of course, the link between performance parameters and yield, they are critical for success. And we need to build that into the databases, and we will. I've not really talked about all the products we made for the different areas, but I try to give you a glimpse of what could be a possible way. For me, there's no doubt that cell factories will be a very, very efficient way of producing protein and amino acids in the future. So it will be a good way of securing that we have the protein we need. For me, there's absolutely no doubt we can make whatever functionality in health, taste, flavor, safety, sustainability we want. It's a matter of putting resources and money after it, then we can do it. Just one example, we have around 150 taste receptors on our tongue. They are cloned and expressed. If you put them on a chip, you can suddenly mimic what kind of a specific product, what kind of taste or flavor profile it'll give you as a person. This will be coming, and it's just one example. Then you could say new polymers, or maybe it's called new materials. I'm a strong believer in making building blocks from renewables, so we should make plastic from renewables. Personally, I spent almost 10 years making 3HP for BASF, just to find out that the oil prices dived from $120 to $20 per barrel, and then they didn't want to continue, even though we got to a point where we had 90% carbon efficiency in making 3HP in a production host. And of course, that's annoying when that happens. We just have to say in 10 years, then maybe there'll be need for this, so we just put it on the shelf and hope that there'll be a need for this in 10 years. But of course, again, when you work with these forefront technologies, timing is also quite crucial. And once in a while, the timing is not with you. But I have no doubt that we can make a massive amount of new material, and we will not be dependent on producing plastic from petrochemicals in the future. Cell factories will give us these solutions. And there's almost unlimited opportunities, in my mind. Yeah, then more to industrial products, and I shall try to make it fast. You can imagine that we can make enzymes many, many more places. Just to tell you, one of the last examples that we did, and I think it has been launched this year, an enzyme for hygiene performance in laundry detergent. And it's a dream which came true. When I was an application scientist, when we made the lipase too, we isolated microbes from people with bad armpit smell. And I can tell you, then we grew them on agar plates and we were sniffing these to find out how bad they smell. And I can tell you, they smell really bad. And we've searched nature for enzymes for many, many years. And we never really found something we were. Until around 2013-14, a group of scientists at Newcastle University came up with an interesting idea. And it turned out that what makes microbes stick to many surfaces, and you would be surprised too, do you have a guess which polymer it is? It's DNA. DNA is extremely sticky. And besides sticking microbes in the armpits and in your underwear, it does actually also stick quite a bit of dirt to your clothes. And so very recently, a very efficient alkaline DNAs have been launched in some of the detergents, which will remarkably reduce the odor and also make your clothes much cleaner. So that may be enzyme number 8 or 9, which is being put into a laundry detergent, and it'll dramatically reduce the malodor from your armpit. And especially males should be happy for this, I guess. And at least those who are doing sports would also be very happy for this, because that's typically what is a problem. And I am unfortunately running out of time, but there will be a lot of microbial based, so products based on whole microbes, increasing plant growth, yield, disease control. This is a really, really large research area. Novozymes and Monsanto have teamed up on this. This will be natural microbes. Just to put in a funny story, in that collaboration, we need to take all the microbes from the United States. We can't take an American microbe, move it to Denmark, work with it in the lab, it's the same microbe, we can't send it back to the US, then it's not American any longer. But apparently the authorities have forgot each time you walk in and out of an airplane, your shoes will carry thousands of microbes. And it just tells you a little bit how screwed up the regulatory system is and the legal system, because they simply don't get it. Because there should be no issue in transporting a microbe forward and backwards. But that's how it's considered if you look at the rules as they are. Yeah. And sustainable products is obvious. Fermentation, no doubt it could be a source of protein. We can take this link. So if we should wrap up, then in my mind, I think cell factors are fantastic. Of course, it's still early days. We have to continue forefront research, and basic research have to continue. And there, of course, partnerships between companies and universities is essential across the globe, because it's not something companies can do alone, not something individual research groups can do alone. So partnerships is really, really important. Development of all these new technology toolboxes. We are still just at a starting point. There's so much to go for. And of course, breakthrough understanding to put this into perspective. And it will give us a multitude of proteins and metabolites which can be used for all kind of stuff. So personally, I must say biotechnology and the utilization and understanding of genes and GMO have never been in a better position. I realize we are going to discuss the ethical issues and some of the barriers which may occur, and we'll do that later. But thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for a very interesting presentation. Are there any questions for Per Falholt then? Yeah.
So you were speaking a lot about, or a little bit about, new data systems to be able to handle everything that would come up from information perspective and store them. There is a lot of research, and also Google, you mentioned them, have this genome research or genome database where you, or cloud database where you can store information. So cloud computing is something that is getting hot to store information in a database. What do you think is going to be the applications of these, but also future problems of utilizing cloud computing in, from a collaborative perspective?
Yeah, of course, from a collaborative perspective, if it's only one company sitting on the information there, it could be problematic because it could be utilized in a non-preferential way. I maybe think the biggest issue we have is if you look at the human intelligence, there was some talk earlier from Jennifer about, can we improve the intelligence of humans a little bit? I think it's actually irrelevant. If you compare today, we typically measure intelligence in 7 different levels. Ant is level 1, humans are level 7. Our computers are getting pretty intelligent right now. I would actually say that the smartest computers, they are roughly on the level of the human right now. In 5 years, we will be on level 1 as humans, and the computer will be at level 7. How are we going to balance this, that the computer is suddenly way, way smarter, way better than us? Is that part of natural evolution? Question mark. And how are we going to deal with this? I think that's maybe a bigger issue than whether we deal with GMO one way or the other. I realize that GMO can be misused in many ways, but I think actually the impact of artificial intelligence and how we use that is maybe a bigger ethical dilemma for us as humans if we want to be continue to be at this level 7, which maybe is already too late because the computer is maybe wiser than we are already. But it's an interesting dilemma, and if you look at the track record of making regulation for new technology, it can make you a little bit worried.
I have a question then.
Yes.
It's a This is also related to Stefan's talk in the beginning. You mentioned the 3HP projects, the 3-hydroxypropanoic acid,
yes,
which has been really challenged. It's been a real challenge to make
it
a
was
cell
a nightmare.
Factory.
It was a nightmare. We used 30 scientists for 8 years to get where we got, just to find out that oil price could kill it.
Yeah, and so I know that even technically it's challenging to produce this compound using a cell. So this is the idea, right? So you use a cell to produce this compound from sugar. So my question then, and you also talked about how the profit disappeared. So how often, I mean...
How often it happens?
How often does that happen, exactly?
Oh, too often.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, but you know, I said I brought 200 molecules to the market. That was while I was the head of R&D. That was from around 2000 to 2016. I made a very thorough analysis from 2004 to 2012. There we brought 55 molecules to the market. And I would say 9 of them met their... They succeeded their target. 20 of them made the financial target. Mm. And to quote the head of marketing, the last 35... In the best case, they make no damage in the market. So that tells you a little bit about the success rate, even for the product we put on the market.
Yeah.
3HP never made it to the market.
Right.
But we spent quite some resources. But that's part of the game. Yeah. And when I look at the success rate in the pipeline, we had around between 20 and 30% success rate. And that's actually, for scientists, pretty high. Okay. And I hope it's a world record, but I don't know, of course.
Yeah, but this is. I also work in the field, kind of microbial engineering, and this is always a question you get about: is it going to work economically?
But I can tell you, we heard this about MRSA resistance, and I say good luck to the guys who made this. I worked 10 years on making a protein which could kill MRSA, just to realize that there's no pharma company who will ever invest the money to bring it to the market, because the too few people dies of MRSA. The moment it becomes serious, then people will do it, of course. But the market for MRSA resistance and people who die from this is too small.
Yeah. We have a question here.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I gather from your talk that you aim to reuse data and use computers to assess the enormous databases we will get. Now, how will that link to the GDPR? How do you foresee the law development and the usage of the restriction that we every time have to indicate where this data is going to be used and where we want to use the data for completely different purposes in the future?
Yeah, I guess, of course, those who own the data, they don't ask, they can do it. But of course, if you want to share it, of course, you need to have a legal agreement where you can do this without breaking the new data regulation.
Because as it's written now, you will have to re-gather data again for every new question.
But not if you hold it privately. But I realize it's going to be an issue for the public institutions.
Yes, for the whole healthcare and life science
it's gonna
sector.
It's going to be a nightmare. But I think it's again for me it's not surprising. But when you said ask lawyers to do this, you end up with a result like this.
But
because
why
they don't have no clue. They are asked to make a law which covers a field which they don't understand.
But how can the scientists in Europe be so weak, so they don't?
Yeah, because unfortunately the scientists have been hiding. I think actually, and it's of course partly scientists' own fault, because what happened in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, where scientists said this is completely safe, this is never going to hurt us. There, the scientific community lost credibility. So the politicians don't listen to scientists. Of course, we need to try to get back on that track, to try to tell what are the good opportunities, what are the risks, and try to get a balance. But the politicians, they don't have a clue how to do this. So it's up to us to help them and the lawyers to make systems which make sense. But unfortunately, each time I see something happen from governmental side, it's very, very few times that it makes sense.
This is an excellent topic for the panelists.
Yes, I think
today,
so too.
And tomorrow as well, because we will have one about the data sharing and the health services as well. Okay, so I think that we cut it here because for time. But thank you again, Per, for a very nice presentation.